Hello, I'm Carol Schiller. I'm the president and founder of the University Neighborhood Organization, and we're really excited to be a part of today's event and want to do a special thanks to Hillary Bassett, the president, and also Julie Larry is going to be giving the presentation. The University Neighborhood Organization, so you don't know, if you don't know, it's a partnership with University USM students, and what we do is we try to make a bridge and bring positive things to our neighborhood from the talents and all the great things that the kids are learning over at USM. For example, we do the annual Longfellow Park Earth Day cleanup, which this year is going to be Friday, April 21st, and that's followed by the Longfellow Park annual block party. And this year it's really, really special because we're celebrating the park's 90th birthday. The park was formed in 1927, and I'll actually be working with Julie to put together a special little handout on the park. We've been doing a lot of research and have found some really interesting clippings. We also are excited to say that the City of Portland finally widened our path walkways, and the park is now pretty much ADA compliant for wheelchair accessibility, which is really a big asset, as many of you know, in the neighborhood. We have the Portland Living Center and many, many residents that need assistance walking, so by widening the walkways is really fantastic. We also did a partnership here with Hope Gateway, Trinity Church, and Woodford's Congregational Church. When the Noy Street fire happened, our students were very involved in organizing the vigil and future anniversaries that will be held in the park. So also, I just want to let you know, if you don't know, there's a forum called Next Door. How many of you are on the Next Door forum? It's wonderful, and if you sign your name and email here, I'll make sure you get an invitation. It's a way to like advertise if you want to sell a car, you want a tenant for an apartment, or whatever information you want to share, or you want information about like today's event, you can post whatever you want on it. And how many people here are actually live in the Oakdale neighborhood? Wow, what a great
Can you give us
the boundaries? I would say the boundaries are basically the neighborhoods that surround the USM neighborhood, you know. It was basically, I think of it from Bedford Street, up Forest Avenue, you know, Woodford's in that block in there. But Julie's going to tell you a lot more about that. So anyways, is anyone here lived 40 years or more in the neighborhood? Any newcomers, et cetera? I think our neighborhood's just really, so many people are discovering it now that it's just really an exciting place to live. So I'm going to turn this over to Julie. Hillary?
Thank you, Carol, and thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm Hillary Bassett. I'm the Executive Director of Greater Portland Landmarks, and I'd like to welcome all of you here today. I'd like to extend a very warm thank you to Hope Gateway for letting us use the space. It's a very creative reuse of a former automotive building, so this is an area that has had a lot of change over the years. And also to Carol from the Neighborhood Association, who's been so great to work with in getting everybody here today. Landmarks was founded in 1964 in response to the urban renewal movement when a lot of buildings were being destroyed in the name of progress. And our mission is to preserve and revitalize Greater Portland's remarkable legacy of historic buildings, neighborhoods, landscapes, and parks. We are calling 2017 the year of the streetcar suburb. So we're going off peninsula. We've been doing a lot of research in the Deering area, in the area particularly out Forest Avenue and Brighton Avenue. And so we'll be sharing that research with you as we find it in the coming years and obviously today. Now, many of these neighborhoods are great neighborhoods to live in, as you all know, but are being rediscovered. And their popularity is being increasing. And also neighborhoods like Woodford's Corner, which really weren't considered a, quote, neighborhood, are gaining their own identity and finding neighborhood organizations to support development there. Now, I'd like to invite you to a couple of Landmarks events that are coming up. One is called Preservation in Action. You may have seen these postcards at the back of the room. It's an event that focuses on connecting homeowners with the people who can help you repair and renovate your properties, and also with realtors and other experts. So that's April 1st. And for neighborhood organizations, we have a special arrangement to have a discounted price for you. So if you're interested, please stop by the table at the back of the room. You can sign up online and use the special term neighbor when you sign up, and you'll get a discounted price on that day of workshops. Another thing that's coming up is a lecture on Tuesday, March 21st with Kent Ryden. Kent is the former head of the American New England Studies program at USM. That will be at the Portland Public Library, and it will be dealing with the idea of place as can be read through the cultural landscape. I think you'll really enjoy hearing from Kent. It's a free lecture on March 21st. And then I'd like to introduce our speaker today. Julie Larry is on our staff at Landmarks as Director of Advocacy. She's an architectural historian and a trained architect. She's done an extraordinary job. She's been on the staff since October 2015, and she has been involved with over 70 projects, review projects in Portland. There's so much going on here, in Greater Portland, I should say. And then she's also been the key player for a number of surveys we've been conducting in the Deering area. We did Oakdale last summer. The previous summer, we did the Forest and Stevens Avenue corridors. This summer, we're going to be working on Deering Highlands. So as we have this information, we look forward to sharing it with the people of Portland. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Julie, who is going to be our speaker.
Thank you. Okay, let's make sure all the tech works. So Greater Portland Landmarks for many years was focused on studying the history of the peninsula. And but a few years back, we decided that one of the areas that we hadn't studied very much was the Deering neighborhood. And so Greater Portland Landmarks published this book, which is called Deering, A Social and Architectural History. We have some available at the back of the room. 2012, I think, was the year it was published. And a lot of the research that we've been doing has built upon the work that was done by Patricia and Bill Berry as per that publication. As Hillary mentioned, we've been doing a number of surveys, and this map shows the location of the neighborhoods we've been working in. So we are, let's see. There we go. So we're about right here today. And this summer we're going to be working in the Deering Highlands neighborhood. Let's see if this one will work. That's the blue. I think it doesn't like me. Oh, here we go. And then this is the Oakdale, Fessenden Park, and Oakwood Heights neighborhoods that I'm going to talk about tonight. So this is Forest Avenue, Stevens Avenue, and Evergreen Cemetery, and of course Baxter Boulevard over here. So the purple are the projects, the locations that we surveyed a couple of summers ago. We had two interns this summer that did these 372 properties within this area, and then this summer we're going to be working up here. And the reason we focused our survey work this previous summer in 2016 on the Oakdale neighborhood was after the fire at 26 Noyes Street, one of the adjacent neighbors applied for some funding to repair the damage done to his property. And part of that funding was from federal sources. And when you use federal money or you require a federal permit, you have to go through a process called Section 106 review. And Section 106 considers the impact of the work that you're going to be doing on historic resources. And when the Maine Historic Preservation Commission did their review of that project, what they did was they decided that they made a determination that there is a potential historic district here in the Oakdale neighborhood. And they said that there needed to be some further evaluation. There had been a survey done. It's about almost 20 years old now. And so they wanted to know, you know, how has the neighborhood changed? What are the resources like today? And so that's why we decided to undertake this neighborhood to update that survey and to have the most accurate information that we could have. So they looked and said, this is Noyes Street here, this is Brighton Avenue, this is St. John, this is Falmouth Street, and then Forest Avenue. So it's pretty much that whole swath they determined could potentially be a district. So that area is is a combination of three subdivisions, early subdivisions. We have the Oakdale subdivision, which is the largest, that was started in 1881. So it goes from Falmouth to Noyes Street, from Forest Avenue to Deering. Then there's this more triangular shaped subdivision that was laid out in 1897. This is Fessenden Park. And then about the time that both of these were almost entirely all built out, they laid out this subdivision, which is the Oakwood Heights subdivision, in the 1920s. And so these are the three that I'll be referring to this evening. And just to place you, here we have Woodford's Corner up here, the existing railroad, and this is the University of Southern Maine. This is a bird's eye image from 1871. This is taken from the peninsula. This is Outer Congress and Congress Street coming through downtown. So this is Deering Oaks. So you can see the city, 1871, is fairly built up. And when you look out here, it looks like the hinterlands. Nobody out there. There be wolves or something like that. But that's actually not true. There was quite a bit of development happening in the 1870s beyond the peninsula. This is a series of maps that shows the evolution of what we know today as Deering. Initially, Deering, Portland, Westbrook, South Portland, Cape Elizabeth, and Falmouth were all one community called Falmouth. The Portland Peninsula, because it leading up to the American Revolution, was really a prosperous port area separated from the rest of the community. And then eventually, Deering was left with Westbrook to form a community called Sacarapa. Now, Westbrook, we know, has a, you know, had a vibrant mill economy, and so they really didn't have the same kind of focus that the Deering, the residential area here in Deering, this was, at the time, was comprised mainly of several small villages. So those two separated in 1871, and Deering became the town of Deering. It later became the city of Deering, and then eventually was annexed by the city of Portland in 1899. They wanted the votes. All of the wealthier people were moving off to Deering, and they're like, hey, we want you back. This is a map showing the town line in, so this is 1882, so this is when Deering was happening up here. So this is Back Cove. This is about where Hannaford is now. This is Deering Oaks. This is Deering Avenue going straight up, and that's Brighton going out there. So you can see this is the town line. It kind of picks up and goes right around USM. At the time, Deering was comprised of a lot of large estate homes, and one of the largest estates, was about a 200-acre estate, was that of James Deering. This is the Deering Mansion, about 1900. James Deering's house was located on what is today USM's campus. The only remainder from that estate is actually the farmhand's house, the corner of Bedford and Deering. There's a small little house that looks kind of out of place on the campus. That's the only existing building that remains. Here's an image of the campus. So the farmhand's house is right here off this slide. This is Bedford Street. This is Forest Avenue down here. This is a subdivision called Bedford Park, and this was the Deering Mansion on USM's campus. Deering's estate was built in the early 19th century, but there were a number of other estate homes that were built up along Forest Avenue in the mid 19th century. This is Forest Avenue here. Woodford's Corner is off the map, just up here. This is the Sparrow, the Coyle, the Ricker, and the Gould estates. They all stretched from Forest Avenue all the way down to the Cove. This is the Coyle House. This is a painting of the Coyle House. Captain Coyle made his money in the steamship business. His estate was eventually subdivided and became a subdivision known as Coyle Park. A portion of his house, the back portion, was separated and moved to Clifton Street. So that's still an existing dwelling today. His house remained on Forest Avenue, was located between Coyle and Belmont Streets until the 1960s when it was torn down for a parking lot. About where we are today was this building. This is the Warren Brown House. It was a Gothic Revival building. It was eventually purchased by a man named Joseph Ricker, who owned a tannery. He was also one of the founders of the Street Railway Company. That was the streetcar line that stretched from the Portland Peninsula, came out Forest Avenue to Woodford's, went just beyond Woodford's and turned onto Pleasant Avenue, went by the house of another founder of the Street Railway Company who subdivided his land, out to Stevens Avenue where it took a right, went out past UNE, which of course was then Westbrook Seminary, to Morrill's Corner. The Ricker Estate was later owned by the Ku Klux Klan until 1923 when it was burned. Here it is during the period of the Klan ownership. You can see the house on the right, and the large building to the left was their dance hall and assembly building. They held dances and rallies and things in the building. Moving towards Portland in the area now occupied by Burger King and TD Bank, CVS, that area, was this building, Oakland's, which was initially the home of the Gould family, and it later was purchased by members of the Brown family. The Brown family owned the Berlin Mills in Berlin, New Hampshire. They would ship their lumber down to Portland. They initially owned the Rufus Deering site on the Portland waterfront, and that was the Berlin Lumber Yard, and then they owned the wharves across the street from where, that's still called Berlin Wharf today. And this later, as I mentioned, was subdivided for use by the Forest Park, as it mentions up there. And prior to the strip mall that's there today, there was a Howard Johnson's on the site. So these estates were gradually split up and subdivided because of mounting pressure for housing off the peninsula. In 1866, there was a massive fire in Portland, the Great Fire of 1866. It started about where Rufus Deering is today and spread all the way up towards Munjoy Hill and the Portland Observatory. It left 10,000 people homeless, so there was a dire need for new housing. Initially, the downtown area had been a very mixed-use place of housing right next door to commercial properties. And there was more of a separation that happened after the fire during the rebuilding. There was a concentration of the commercial uses in what we now call the downtown. And then there was residential development on Bramhall Hill and on Munjoy Hill. And for those who could afford it, there was housing that was built in Deering. Now, it took a little bit longer. You couldn't walk like you could from Bramhall and Munjoy Hill to your work. So you needed to have a little bit more money so that you could afford a horse and a carriage that would take you into town. But in 1864, we have the first horse-drawn streetcars that came out, started at India Street, went up to Congress Street, rather, and then went out Forest, as I mentioned, taken to Pleasant, and then out to Morrill's Corner. And so if you lived within 5 or 10 minutes of the streetcar, you could be to work fairly economically and fairly quickly. And that allowed for the subdivision of these large estates into new homes. One of the proponents of the subdivision of Deering into a residential neighborhood was the International Order of Odd Fellows. They published this document called Deering, A City of Homes in 1897. This was just as Deering was about to be annexed by the city of Portland. That was helping to promote why you should move out of the city and into the suburban ideal of Deering. So this is a map from 1914. This shows the subdivision of the Coyle house that I showed you the painting earlier. This was the Ricker estate that the KKK owned. You can see that here in 1914, it hasn't been subdivided yet. The Brown estate has not yet been built up. We have this development on the side of Back Cove called Boulevard Park that has just a couple of houses that have been built up. Here's Deering. Here's the Oakdale neighborhood. This is the Fessenden Park subdivision, sparsely developed. You can see that there's a lot of development over here, but none over towards Noyes Street. Development in this subdivision moved from this end down the street and eventually hooked up with some of the development that had been happening around Woodford's Corner. And we have the Oakwood Heights site just off the map, which is not developed. Again, that didn't develop until the 20s. The streetcars were eventually supplanted by the automobile. And the automobile had a huge impact on Forest Avenue and on the suburban neighborhoods off of Forest Avenue. Initially, there was a need to, where are you going to put your car? So this is one of the, this is a auto dealership that was demolished for $295. Automobile dealerships initially were on the peninsula, and then they eventually migrated out to Forest Avenue, and so a number of the properties on Forest Avenue are auto dealerships, including this building that we're in. You can see the very large columns, the four columns in this main space. These were this was a typical form of concrete structure that was used to create these big open spaces that you could park a car into. This map shows the location of a number of those auto dealerships. This is before 295 goes in. So this is Deering Oaks here. This is the USM campus. So this is where Oakhurst was, or Oakhurst is. They eventually expanded and took over what was an auto dealership here on the corner of Falmouth. There was a number over here on the other side of the street, one where for many years, Pier 1, that building, if those of you have been around for a while. And then there was another one on this street that no longer exists because the library has taken it over. There was a big Forest City Chevrolet. I think I might have an image of that coming up. And then there were a number of them out towards Woodford's Corner as well. There's this one. This is a 1924 tax photo on the top. The city of Portland has an image of every income-producing property in the city from 1924. This is a more recent, but not super current. This is going to be the new location of the Bakery Collective and a new art gallery that's going into this space. There's a couple of those a little bit closer down towards 295. And this was Forest City. For those of you who've been around for a long time, Forest City for many years after they left this location was out by the old Exit 8, which I think is 48 now, on Brighton Avenue. They're now Quirk Chevrolet. And you can see in the back the old bakery building, which is now the library for USM. Here's an image from the 40s that I just really love because it shows all kinds of transportation types. We have, of course, this image, which we don't see much of in Portland, right? Although maybe Tuesday night we'll need to use this form of transportation. We have some of the cars and truck traffic, but you can also still see the rails for the streetcar lines in the street. And here's a number of those auto dealership buildings across the street. So where do you store a car once you've purchased a car? Well, one of the earliest places was a community garage. This is on Oakdale Street. The image in the upper left is what it looks like today. On the lower right is the 1924 photo. You can see in the center, there was initially a pair of swinging doors that you could drive the cars into. And this was built by Silas Adams, who was a vice president of the American Chicle Company. They made gum. They took over one of the chewing gum manufacturers in the city of Portland. So he lived out here in Deering and worked in town, and he built this garage for him and his neighbors. But mostly what we know is the individual garage on your own property. Now, a number of the carriage barns that would have had maybe a horse and a carriage for somebody were converted, as you can see on the left, with a garage door. We have another form of a community, perhaps a community garage, a three-bay hip roof garage in the center. But the most predominant type of garage that we see in this early 20th century is the single car garage that you can't fit an SUV into anymore, with either a hip or a gable roof. Some of them were actually done quite fancy and matched the style of the house. So now I'm going to talk about the three neighborhoods individually. We'll start with Oakdale in 1881. When Oakdale was laid out, this is Falmouth Street, Forest Avenue, and Deering Avenue. It was initially bisected by the Portland and Rochester Railroad, so the train came right through the neighborhood. Eventually, when the railroad went out of business in 1911, those lots were subdivided for additional housing. So when you start on Forest Avenue and you start driving down some of these streets, you'll find that there's some earlier houses just as you go off Forest Avenue because these became house lots. Except for this end of the development where it became Freeman Street. It was left open. Oh, and here's just showing the subdivision of the lots, the railroad right-of-way. Now, a number of the streets in this subdivision are William, Pitt, and Fessenden. And those are named for U.S. Senator William Pitt Fessenden, who married a daughter, Ellen, of James Deering. So when the Deering Land Company subdivided this land, they purchased 40 acres, I think it was, from James Deering of his 200 acres from his family for this subdivision. So here are some of the homes. Mostly, initially, single family, large homes, particularly large considering the size of their lot. So you have the Clifford House in the upper left. You have some Queen Anne homes, 92 to 96 Fessenden Street, matching houses with identical towers and porches, probably built as spec houses by the Deering Land Company. A number of the homes, like the Clifford House, were built specifically by the property owner, but the land company that was selling also wanted to show what was possible, and so they did a number of homes on spec, much like you might see in a subdivision if you were out in Falmouth or Cumberland today. Below, although it needs some TLC and a good paint, this is the Hawes House at 69 Falmouth Street. It has an amazing amount of detail left on that building. And then this sweet little house, the Murphy House at 90 Pitt Street, fairly small in comparison to many of the homes in the neighborhood. A number of homes in the neighborhood look alike. you can see these are very similar. They all have a central entrance and a full-width porch. They have brackets supporting the overhanging roof, three windows at the top. Then they have some sort of feature window. This one's obviously a mirrored image of that one. This one, and you can still see that original feature. I'm sorry, that one's a little dark. And then the paired columns on the porch. Again, probably a builder building these on speculation to sell. Again, another grouping of houses, very similar, probably spec houses. You have the paired porch columns, the full-width porch, the big dormers, the little rectangular window. And as you can see, these are Noyes and Dartmouth Street. So these were built on the far end, the western end of the neighborhood. As the neighborhood developed in Oakdale, there was less and less of the individual homes that were built. And then you see more and more spec housing. And so there are a number of the houses on that end of the neighborhood do look a lot alike. Also on that end of the neighborhood, as it was built up, there's less and less single family, and you start to see more two-family homes. This enabled people who maybe couldn't afford to buy a single family home the ability to live in this neighborhood because they had the income from the rent. And many of the early two-family homes were built to look like their neighbors that were single-family homes. So again, you have the full-width porch on some of these, you have the dormer. Except for the double door, there's not a lot to give it away that it's a two-family. It's about the same size and scale and has a lot of the same details as its single-family neighbors. Another way to get more density into the neighborhood was the triple-decker. This was also another way to be able to afford to live in the neighborhood because now you had two rents coming in potentially. Or what often happened was you had two families that, you know, so maybe mom and dad and then the kids and then grandma and grandpa lived downstairs and then they rented out a third unit. You can see these are two of the triple deckers. These became very popular, as we know, all throughout New England. Lots of light allowed into the building, Almost always they had a porch. This one has lost all its upper porches in the neighborhood, but this one still has its fantastic original balconies. The Oakdale neighborhood had a number of the amenities that you might expect in a neighborhood, including a school. This is the Oakdale School. This is an early image from 1885 and a more recent image. It's now used for housing. This was the neighborhood school right up until Nathan Clifford was built on Falmouth Street. And then after that point, this was used initially as a kindergarten. It had a couple of other uses, and then it was vacant for a while and the city sold it and it was converted to housing. Right, and there's Nathan Clifford. Right next door to the Oakdale School was this dwelling that had a storefront added onto it. The storefront was then removed. It was only in place for about 30 years. This was called Oakdale Pure Foods Neighborhood Grocery Store. And then where the railroad tracks were removed on Fessenden Street, this building was constructed. Initially it was used as a bakery, then it was Bicknell Manufacturing Company with these large storefront windows. And then when the company moved out, they took out the storefront, added the bay windows, and converted it into housing. Then at the end of the neighborhood, we have, as Carol was talking about earlier, we have Longfellow Park. This is an early plan from the 20s and an image of it today. You can see the cross pattern. And then the next one we'll talk about is Fessenden Park. It was laid out in 1897. The following year, a new streetcar line went out Brighton Avenue out to Rosemont, and that helped to shorten the walk and make that subdivision more popular because you wanted to be within 5 to 10 minutes of the streetcar. That was kind of what the land developers were selling. Fessenden Park is a smaller subdivision. It has slightly larger lots than the Oakdale subdivision, and it has, for the most part, some really individual, unique houses that were specifically designed for certain residents. So we have the Peterson House on the upper left. This is a little bit later, so these houses are more in what was becoming the popular shingle style. It has a little bit of colonial revival influence as well. So you can start to see the gambrel roof forms being used. That was a popular roof feature for the shingle style homes. And then we still have a little bit of Queen Anne. I call Queen Anne architecture everything but the kitchen sink architecture. You can have arches, towers, bay windows, dormers, porches, anything you want. It's just kind of a riot of features on your house. Here's some more. There's another one with a nice big gambrel roof. The two on the right-hand side, you can see, have a relationship with a Dr. King. Dr. King was a graduate of the Maine Medical School. The Maine Medical School was located at Bowdoin College. He graduated from there. He taught there. He was a practitioner at Maine Medical Center, which was not called Maine Medical Center at the time. And so this was the house on the lower right that he built for himself. And then he opened up a hospital nearby on William Street for nurses training school. Became so popular that they expanded and purchased another building and connected the two buildings. And those were in operation until about the Great Depression, about that period of time. Like Oakdale, the neighborhood developed from the Portland side towards the the Westbrook side. And so most of the early homes are the large, individual, very over-the-top houses. And then we have some more modest houses as you move back towards Noyes Street. And you start to see, again, some of the two-family houses being built as you move backwards through the neighborhood. Fessenden Park took a fairly long time to develop. As it was laid out in 1897, and it wasn't fully built up until 1923. And it only has about 40 lots in it, too. One of the things that it does have is an apartment building, and then that's real density in a neighborhood, right? This is the Hinescroft apartment building, and that's a 1924 photo, and then a more recent image from last fall. The last neighborhood that I'm going to talk about is the Oakwood Heights plan. Oakwood Heights was laid out when the two other neighborhoods were essentially all developed. At the time, there was a number of subdivisions going in around what we would call the USM community today. Just south of Bedford Street was the Bedford Park development. There was another one behind where the law school library is now, and then Oakwood Heights. And they were all done around the same time period as the Oakdale, Fessenden, and Oakwood Heights. The Oakwood Heights and the Bedford Park were both done by the same gentleman. And that developer's name was Thomas Sanders. He lived on Williams Street, so he lived in the Fessenden Park neighborhood and purchased land from the Deering heirs to build those two subdivisions. These are the streets, Catherine, Kenwood, Sheffield, and Woodmont Street. It's 121 parcels. Most of them are about 50 by 100 feet, rather. The lots came with deeded restrictions. It was a 25-year deed restriction. They stipulated that no part or portion of the lot could contain a store, factory, theater, hospital, stable, garage, public garage, or any building to be used for commercial or industrial use. It was meant to be a purely residential neighborhood. Homes for more than two families were prohibited. The restrictions called for setbacks. This was an early form of zoning that was done by the developer. 20-foot setbacks at the street, 5-foot side yards. Single-family homes had to be greater than $6,000 in value, exclusive of your land costs. Two-family homes had to be greater in value than $9,000. And there was no livestock. You could not have chickens, you could not have sheep, and they enumerated all of those animals. They did not want any farming going on in this neighborhood. So here's the subdivision plan. This is St. John Street, this is Brighton Avenue, and this is Falmouth. So it didn't include the lots that front onto St. John Street. It just included all of the streets coming off of Brighton. So here are some of the images. Now this neighborhood I mentioned was laid out in 1923. So in 1924, when the city's tax assessor was coming through to take pictures, a number of these homes were under construction or had not yet been built even. So a number of the 1924 photos, you'll see some that have like the stairs are missing, you know, they're still in progress. So here are two early homes. You can see this one's had its porch filled in. This one still looks remarkably like it did in 1924. There's its cool little two-car garage out back. What we found was that a number of the homes in this subdivision, we believe, are factory cut or mail order homes or homes inspired by those catalogs called kits. They were very popular in the early 20th century, and there were a number of national companies that operated during this period, the most famous of which is Sears and Roebuck out of Chicago. Montgomery Ward's also sold kit homes. There was a company called Gordon Van Tine. There's one of those in this neighborhood. And another company called Bennett Homes that was out of Towanda, New York. This one is, I believe, a Sears modern home. The only way to definitively know is to find a bill of sale or markings within the house, and I haven't been in any of these homes. But this home on Kenwood Street, you can see it has the fairly steep pitch of the front addition. It has the little unusual window there, and then it had this big porch that's been filled in. So I believe this one probably is the Glen Falls version of Sears, and you can see this is the floor plan. It would give you your options that you could have. This one is a standard homes, I believe. You can see it has a little eyebrow window up there. This one was recently on the market, so I've seen the interior photos of this one. Here's one of their images of the breakfast nook, which is right here in the floor plan. In fact, this one, when it was sold a year or so ago, the kitchen was original and matched this exact layout. It was like a time warp in this house. I'd love to go into it now and see what they've done. There's another one that I believe is probably this is Gordon Van Tine, is one of those, is like Sears. This is the Hudson House. You can see the details of the Hudson is this prominent chimney, this projecting entrance door, which we have right here. This is kind of a mirror image of that. And you can see this unique open lattice window that looked into the porch from the street that still exists today, although I think it may have been filled in on the other side. They don't have the open porch. But here's the image of it in 1924. It's very clearly, it's even got the same pediment above the door. This was one of our interns that did the survey work. They loved this house. They're like, we don't know why we like this house, but we really do. But it's really strange. And then when I got... Yes, it's got some Tudor, which still exists. It's hard to see in this image, but it's still got some of its Tudor detailing right here, which you can see right there in that image. This has been altered. This is what it was in 1924 when it was under construction. You can see the stairs are missing out here. They've lost their chimney because they put in a dormer window. This still exists, although they've extended it out a little bit. You can see the clipped hip roof is still there, and then you can barely see it right here. There's this long slope has a cutout in it, and that's a passageway to go out along the side of the building to go out to the backyard, and that still exists today. They've got a little gate that they've filled it in with. So this started us on a journey of learning more about mail order buildings, homes in the greater Portland area. And coincidentally, at the same time, in Lincoln Park, Tempo Art sponsored a new piece of work by an artist, Judith Hoffman. And she used, it's called The American Dream, is the name of her sculpture. And she based it off some of the Sears kit homes, that's what makes up the sculpture. And so we've teamed up with Tempo Art, and we're going to be doing a lecture just on kit homes on April 26th at Luther Bonney at the Talbot Lecture Hall at 6 o'clock in USM. And so if you'd like to learn more about more kit homes, we've been finding more and more across the area and how you can locate and how you can identify a kit home. And as Hillary mentioned, also coming up, we have our preservation and action workshops. So I'm happy to answer any questions you may have. And if not, if you don't have any questions, then we can mingle and I'll be at the back of the room and you can come up and, if you're shy, and ask me a question privately. Yes?
I don't remember, two questions, totally separate. I don't remember the dates of the three different neighborhoods. How many years apart were they approximately?
The question was, what were the dates of the neighborhoods? So Oakdale is 1881, Fessenden Park is 1897, and Oakwood Heights is 1923.
My second question is about, I think on William Street, it looked like when it turned, the styles turned shingled. Did John Calvin Stevens design any of those on William?
Yes. That's the quick answer. Yes, there are some that are on William Street that we believe John Calvin Stevens either designed or did additions and alterations to. Yes.
Anything else? Yes, ma'am.
I am from away, and I have a question about the double and triple decker, homes that have flat roofs.
Yes.
And that seems so counterintuitive to me when considering the weather.
Yes. And everyone who owns a flat roof house in 2 days will be thinking the same thing. yeah, it is. Yeah. It wasn't necessarily about thinking practical, it was about squishing a lot of people on one lot. Developers. No, sorry. That was commentary. Yes, sir, in the back with the maroon.
When did the streetcar stop operating?
The streetcars stopped operating, oh gosh, I want to say 1840s, they were really in declining. I think there were some that still existed around a little bit later than that. Not 1840s, 1940s, sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah. What do you call a neighborhood between, behind Falmouth Street, Lips Pace and Exeter and all those streets behind USM? That's a little gray area in there.
Yeah. I can't remember the name of it. I wanted to say it's something about Exeter Woods or something like that. I can't remember the name of that subdivision, but I think it begins with E, so that's why I'm thinking it's Exeter. Yeah.
Yes.
So the plans survive for each of these, developments?
Yes. Yes, the plans for these developments, for the most part, particularly these later ones from the 1880s onward, are in the Registry of Deeds. So they're very easy to look up. You can just go to the Registry of Deeds, which is online, and just type in to Google Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. They have two ways you can search. You can search by, you can search land records, which is where the maps are, and then you just put in your street name. So if you live on Exeter Street, you can type in Exeter Street, and then you can arrange them by date. And so you look for like the 1920 map and pull it up, and there will be your subdivision.
Yes, in the back.
Did the Ku Klux Klan dance hall burn down they had, or did that mean a different fate?
I believe they burned at the same time, yeah. Yeah. I did a presentation to some kids at King Middle School, and I wasn't sure they'd know who the Ku Klux Klan was, to be honest, but they did. And when I said, you know, the buildings burned, they're like, karma. I'm like, I like you guys. You're fun. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to comment on the flat roofs. I live in the Lafayette on the top floor, and I have had like 7 leaks in the roof in like 15 years.
Yeah.
And.
Yeah, it's not practical, is it?
Library, yeah. And the main branch, and flat roofs are totally against the vernacular, which is a great concept. And so I think it was a stylistic choice.
Well, certainly for the library. Modernism was, you know, most modernist buildings did not have hipped roofs. Or, yeah, I mean, so the flat roofs was definitely, yeah. You will, it's interesting when you go, of course the triple decker just exploded in communities like Dorchester outside of Boston. And so you drive through like South Boston, Dorchester, and you look at some of the triple deckers and what they've done to change the roof form because it's such an impractical, but the Irish are very practical people and they can fix their roofs.
Well, right, and up Munjoy Hill.
Yeah.
There's tons of triple deckers, and they all have flat roofs, that's the immigrant neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Again, it was making a lot of housing, particularly when the triple deckers came in. That was when the big waves of immigrants were coming to Portland. The Irish were first, and then we had the Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe and the Italians and. Yeah, they were here. You know, they were here even earlier.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and so you have these waves of immigrants who initially settled on the peninsula in the India Street neighborhood, the Gorham's Corner neighborhood off York and Danforth Street, and eventually, like moving on up, like the Jeffersons. As soon as they could afford to, they moved up the hill, up Bramhall. That was great consternation when Catholics started moving into the neighborhoods on the West End. They moved up to Munjoy Hill, or when they could, they moved out to here. And of course, in the India Street neighborhood, there are a number of synagogues. That was a very large Jewish community in the India Street neighborhood. And as they moved up, they moved out here. And so you have the synagogue on Noyes Street, which grew out of the synagogue that was on Newbury Street initially in the India Street neighborhood.
Yes, ma'am.
This is a little bit off topic, but I'm dying to know if you've heard, all these plans for refurbishing Woodford's Corner. Have you heard anybody talk about like a Hilltop Coffee or Coffee by Design? There's so many people in these neighborhoods who work at home, and we really need a place.
Yeah.
Get out of the house.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. A lot of people, I've heard people say that, but I don't know of anybody who's opening one. We have a lot of, we work a lot with the Woodford's Corner Friends Group, and we always meet at Big Sky, and you see a lot of people coming in and trying to get their coffee because they just need to get out of the house. So, yeah, the Oddfellows recognize that, and they know that their neighborhood, and I think that they have some interest in helping to spur the regeneration of that corner, and they know that it's time for some new blood in the neighborhood, in the commercial. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Question about Holbrook Heights. St. John Street, right behind there. One of those houses built at St. John's.
I believe those were built closer to World War II, when there was a lot of housing within throughout Greater Portland that was needed to house the workers in South Portland, and that is my best guesstimate. I don't know that for certain.
Not part of the subdivision because they were simply different property owners?
Different property owner, yeah. Yeah. Start in the back.
There's talk about closing off Bedford Street. I guess USM would like to take that street, and looking at the maps, that looks like a very old street. It looks like it's been there.
Yeah. It's because that was the main street that the Deering Mansion's driveway came off of. That street's...
Is that all of those streets?
Yeah, that, and I believe it was called Wilmont Street. That was the street that went down behind the library, what's now the library, and cut across where 295 was. Is it Wilmont? Winslow, that's it, yes, thank you. That was a W. I don't know if I'm going to get back there. Those were very, very early laid out streets. Noyes Street predates all the other streets. Noyes Street was an original street as well. There we go, Noyes. Noyes was laid out before any of these were. These were filled in between Falmouth and here. Noyes was an original street, or predated these streets, I shouldn't say it was original. But yeah, this, coming down here and this path into Portland was a very early road. Yes, in the back?
I've heard that the alignment of Falmouth Street essentially followed what was a creek, and then when they built the sewers and stuff, they piped it and put the street over it. Have you come across any photos?
No, haven't heard that. No. There's some great photos of when the sewer went in across the street. You can see the men digging, going out to Back Cove. Those are pretty cool. Yes, sir?
You mentioned Noyes Street. I believe I heard at one point that Dartmouth Street was actually U.S. Route 1 at one time. Is that
actually? What? I'm sorry?
U.S. Route 1.
Deering Avenue.
Deering Avenue, okay.
Deering, yeah.
Deering Avenue, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Desmond's neighborhood, mm-hmm. You said there was 40 lots there?
40 or 41, yeah.
Why did it take so long for it to fill up and develop?
It was moving.
Yeah, it went through a couple of developers. The early developers were two gentlemen named Marks and Earl. And Marks lived in the neighborhood and built big, large homes, spec homes, which took a while to develop. I believe there was an economic downturn in there as well that didn't help matters, another 2008 kind of situation. And eventually he sold off most of his, those two sold off most of their to another developer whose last name I think was Brown. And then they developed, you can just see it sliding off here. There's this neighborhood over here where Orland Street is. It comes off Brighton Avenue. That's called Fessenden Park Extension. That's the name of that subdivision. They developed that, and then they got out of town, and they went and developed neighborhoods in Brookline outside Boston. So they were those kind of developers. More commentary. Anybody else? All right. Oh, well, I'll catch you out.
Thank you.